In this very room at 12:15 after church. And on Zoom, that room is part of this room. So, elders and deacons. So, I hope that you will be here for that. We have important conversations. You will see there in the bulletin, novelty is also this afternoon. There is a clipboard that really wants your name on it. If it's not there already, it is for signing up for Trunk or Treat, which is Saturday, the 29th of October. It is currently in the narthex, the entryway out there. There are roles for people who want to do things, crafts, food, games, whatnot. There are also on the second page, if you would be willing to bring your trunk and decorate your trunk and pass out candy from your trunk, the one day of the year when we let kids take candy from strangers out of their cars. A little bit of a mixed message, but it's fine. Yeah, everybody understands. So the second page is for those who will be doing their cars, and we definitely need some more of those. So I'd love to have you sign up for that. I do want to draw your attention to the fact that our Pacific Southwest Regional Assembly, for the first time in person since 2018, is this coming weekend on Friday and Saturday up in Fullerton. But if you don't want to drive all the way to Fullerton, you can watch a lot of that assembly. I don't know exactly, I doubt it's all day long because there are giant, long portions of people wandering around talking to each other. Pretty sure they're not gonna live stream that part. But the worship and the business, you should be able to watch on the live stream of the website there. If you just go to the region's website, you can find it. But if you add that slash RA, it's not RA 2002. That is a mistake of my time-addled brain. It is RA 2022. So you'll find it if you go to the region's website to watch the live stream. That also means that I will be gone on Friday, most of Friday, most of Saturday. So please do not need me that day. I appreciate it. Thank you. I will, of course, have my cell phone should there be an emergency, but I am wearing many hats at Regional Assembly this year. So there's...
And you'll be in Fullerton.
And I will be in Fullerton, but they have self-service in Fullerton.
That's true.
So, there is another error in this bulletin. The Associate Pastor Support Committee is not meeting next Sunday. They are meeting on the 23rd, which is the Sunday after that. I was just so excited for y'all to get together. So sorry to confuse you, but I believe that is what we have for announcements. We have a very important birthday tomorrow. I'm gonna ask you to do some panning because tomorrow is Betty Sullivan's birthday. Is she in there? Hi, Betty, we're all gonna wave at you. This is like 90, does anybody know? Two, maybe three? Betty probably knows.
93.
Got you, Betty. And also on Tuesday, it's Sarah Gerling's birthday. So it'd be great if you wanna send her a text, but right now, why don't we sing a song? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. May God richly bless you. Another year through. Amen and amen. Before we come to worship God, Jesus teaches us to reconcile ourselves one to another. The peace of Christ be with you. Let us share those signs. You can turn around. Look at your neighbors behind you too. It's good. It's good. All right. I invite you to stand as you are comfortable and join in singing our gathering song, Song of the Soul.
Thank you.
hands, we gather to worship God this morning, praising God with our whole heart.
We come from every direction, hoping to be part of what God is doing right here.
When we come together as a community, we become something bigger than the sum of our parts. When the boundaries of our community are fuzzy and welcoming, God's love spills over the edges, bringing light and hope to so many more.
Let us give thanks and praise God for the wonderful ways Jesus calls us into ministries of hospitality.
May our faith be renewed today as we open our hearts to the movement of the Holy Spirit.
Let us worship and praise the living God with gratitude.
Please join me in prayer. Precious Lord, Holy One of Israel, may holy wisdom, kind to humanity, steadfast, sure, and free, the breath of the power of God, may she who makes all things new in every age enter our souls and make us friends of God through Jesus Christ. Amen.
You may be seated.
Because half our choir is gone today, we needed a pinch hitter, and I guess that's me. And the Feast of St. Francis was this past week, so this seemed appropriate.
Let me bring pardon. Where there is doubting, let me
see, who do we have on Zoom today, Tessa?
This morning we have Kathy, Daniel, Brenda, Larry, Betty, and Bill, and some other person in.
It's
not right.
Betty's son.
Oh, Betty's son.
He's
waiting for her birthday. And Cheryl.
And Cheryl. Wonderful. Good morning, Zoomers. God loves you. All right. We're so glad to have all of you with us in this room and that room, which is all of the room. So let us move into a time of prayer. As we share the joys and concerns of this community and beyond, we have a Rosebud alert. That lady right there, Grace Van Winkle, and the one next to her, there's a new baby in the Van Winkle family. On Friday, Elodie Noel Korea, Christopher and Lauren, right, are the proud parents. Elodie weighed in at 7 pounds, so we are so grateful to welcome. This is like what, number 17 or something?
Seven,
okay. Things get exaggerated in my head. So God, with joyful hearts, we give you thanks. So we received some sad news yesterday. You may remember that on our prayer list last month, after Welcome Saturday, we lifted up a woman named Rita, who is one of our Welcome Saturday regulars and friends. Always comes in about 11 in her little scooter and takes food home with her or back to wherever for other folks. And we had received the word that Rita had collapsed and was in a coma at the hospital. Some of you may have heard that I was then unable to find her that afternoon. And it turns out that Rita actually passed away that very morning on September 11th or 3 o'clock in the morning or something. So our prayers of sympathy for her son, her brother, who is, I believe, here in town as well, and her many friends, including those of us who knew and loved Rita. So we lift up prayers of sympathy. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We did, however, also have a chance to celebrate 2 birthdays yesterday. You can put a birthday candle in a biscuit. I don't know if you knew that, but it works. So we had 2 birthdays for Joey and for Laura yesterday at Welcome Saturday. God, with joyful hearts, we give you thanks. We're praying with Jenny. I don't know if you said she was with us. She probably isn't. Jenny texted me last night. She was supposed to be doing AV today for the first time, and she is homesick with a fever. Thus far, not testing as COVID, so prayers that that remains the case and that she recovers swiftly. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Sorry, I ran on your line there. We had word from Brenda. I just had word this morning. She is with us, still not feeling great, but the side effects from her treatment that have been causing intense pain, mostly in her mouth, are almost resolved. She has some lingering loss of taste and numbness, but almost there. Brenda is also waiting on results from the PET scan that she had on Wednesday. So big prayers that it will show some major progress from her treatment. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Praying with Mary Jane today, who has been dealing with bad back pain. She's going to see somebody Tuesday. And also prayers for Mary Jane's sister, whom you may have heard of, her sister Leanne, who is currently, she's still in the hospital in Maine, where Mary Jane grew up. Hard to be the supporting sister from that far, but making it work. So prayers for Mary Jane and her sister Leanne. God, in your mercy. Yeah. We always are praying for Betty and her girls, Pam and Cheryl and her niece, Kim, all of those three going through cancer treatments and Betty dealing with some health issues of her own. Did she ever put in the chat box what birthday this actually is, or is it just a secret now?
Somebody said it was 93.
Okay, that sounds about right. So, I mean, hello. So prayers for Betty and Pam and Cheryl and Kim. God, in your mercy. Yeah. Continue prayers for Becky Neely, who is starting to recover from that fall she had 2 weeks ago on the 24th. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Continue prayers for my stepdad as well, who is still on pause with his treatment as the initial side effects wear off that the doctor promises won't come back when he restarts. So prayers that that turns out to be the case when he does restart the gene therapy pills, which hopefully will be this coming week. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We are, of course, continuing to lift up prayers for all those impacted by Hurricane Ian and other storms, those who've lost homes and loved ones, livelihoods, and entire communities, as we know that we'll need to rebuild. Prayers for all those assisting in rescue and recovery. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for women and other protesters in Iran. We pray for all those living under oppressive regimes. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Want to lift up everyone impacted by the mass shooting at a preschool in Thailand earlier this week. Just awful, awful tragedy there. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for three different cells of human rights advocates in Ukraine, Russia, and Belarus who were awarded the Nobel Peace Prize this week for their efforts to bring transparency to human rights violations and various other forms of advocacy. We pray for the continued safety and the inspiring courage of all those working for liberty and self-determination under oppressive regimes. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And we, of course, continue to pray for the war in Ukraine and also this week for tensions in the Korean Peninsula with increased hostile activity there and many people living with anxiety around that. God, in your mercy, we lift up our prayer partners each week. Our global ministry prayer partner this week is Egypt, where Corey Driver is our mission co-worker. I encourage you to go click on that link because I think it's probably him standing at the front of a sanctuary playing an accordion. So, I mean, I need some new skills probably, but also praying for our Pacific Southwest prayer partner this week, which is Mill Creek Christian Church in Bakersfield, where Michael Sutherland is the pastor. We pray for these and all of our partners in ministry. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. So we have prayers from Zoom, Tessa.
We do. Cheryl would like prayer for a co-worker and a good friend by the name of Shamsi and Shamsi's family. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Are there other prayer concerns we can lift up today? And that's okay too. Thank you for getting up and trying, Daphne. So we do continue in prayer. Let us continue in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we come to you with so much on our hearts, spoken and unspoken, recognized and just roiling under the surface. We pray, oh God, that you would soothe the rough waters of our souls, oh God, that you would grant us your peace, that you would grant us your courage and your patience and your passion for doing right in our world, oh God. We pray this day for all those who are struggling, those who need your healing power in their bodies and their minds and their hearts. We pray, oh God, for those who need your hope, those who are struggling to make ends meet, those who are living with inadequate shelter and support and resources. We pray for our children, for our schools, parents and teachers and all who work with our children, oh God. We pray for their safety. We pray for their creativity and their resilience and their joy. We pray, oh God, for the elderly in our midst, that they might find friendship in the face of loneliness, that they might know how very valued they are in our midst. We pray this day for our congregation. Oh God, we ask your blessing on this little gathering of your body here. We pray that you will keep us faithful, that you will guide us forward. We pray this day for those who are preparing even now to join with us in this community of faith. Grant us open hearts and arms. We pray, oh God, that you would Make us a welcoming beacon home for so many who are searching. We pray this day for our community, for our state and our nation and our world, O God. We pray for leaders who wield authority that they might do so with your compassion and humility and wisdom. We pray, O God, for those whose hands are turned toward violence, that you might transform their hearts and their spirits and lead them into deeper understanding, lead them to the paths of peace, O God. We pray for those who need your hope in the face of tragedy and disaster. We pray, O God, that you would bring us together out of the ruins, that you would bring us together as your faithful people, proclaiming hope and liberty and justice. We pray this day for the healing of creation, O God. We pray it all in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So we have, just for the sake of no confusion, we have Eileen Kaiser playing the role of Dick Penny today, Jerry Bailey playing the role of Ray Adson, and me playing the role of Larry Knight. So some understudies today for whom we give thanks.
Our first reading today is from Psalms 111. You can find it on pages 562 and 63 in the Old Testament section of the Red Bibles in the chair racks, if you'd like to follow along. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart, in the company of the upright in the congregation. Great is the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them, full of honor and majesty in his work and in his righteousness, endures forever. He has gained unknown, has gained renown by his wonderful deed. The Lord is gracious and merciful. He provides food for those who fear him. He is ever mindful of his covenant. He has shown his people the power of his works in giving them the heritage of the nations. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever to be performed with faithfulness and righteousness. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever.
Amen.
May the Holy Spirit add blessing to the reading of the Psalms.
Our second reading today is from the book of the prophet Jeremiah, chapter 29, verses 1, 4 through 7. You can find it on page 731 in the Old Testament section of the Red Bibles and Chair Racks, if you would like to follow along. These are the words of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the remaining elders among the exiles and to the priests, the prophets, and all the people whom Nebuchadnezzar had taken into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat what they produce. Take wives and have sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there and do not decrease, but seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile and pray to the Lord on its behalf. For in its welfare, you will find your welfare. May the Holy Spirit add blessing to this reading from the prophet. Will you pray with me and for me as we get into the word this morning? Holy God, bless the speaking and the hearing of these words. that we might seek justice and compassion grounded in the truth of your mercy and love. In Jesus' name. The first reading this morning is a well-known psalm, Psalm 111, which in Hebrew is actually an acrostic poem and used most likely for Jewish festivals. If you were ever wondering or have had anyone ask where in the scriptures one could find about God in the most concise way, you can send them to this psalm. The beginning says, praise God. The end says, praise God. And in the middle, we hear why. God's actions of justice and mercy and righteousness, deliverance, and covenant keeping have proven to the Israelite people that God should be praised. The psalm says that God's relationship with humanity shows that God cares for creation, and as a reaction, we praise God with our whole hearts. However, within this context, and for the Israelite people, a heart wasn't just a host for emotions, but a host for, quote, morality, spirituality, determination, and intellect. So the praise we give is one living out our lives in such a way that imitates the God of compassion, of justice, and mercy in action, as the psalmist notes. The word deed or action is noted multiple times throughout the psalm. Again, it's about an active faith, active praise to the one who models what it is we need to do. So then, how do we read Jeremiah, knowing the words of Psalm 111? Jeremiah is speaking to a people removed from their homes and brought to a foreign land as captives of war, dealing with the destruction of their identity and their foundation as the people of God, especially when he is saying things that contradict the other prophets of his time. In contrast to Jeremiah, other prophets talked about the fact that exile would be over quickly. Just a couple years, they said. One or two, two or three, give or take. Jeremiah's mention of building houses and planting gardens and having multiple generations means that the people will most likely be there for some time. Get situated, Jeremiah says. Jeremiah reminds the people that your foundation, your home, where you build your life, does not need to be a specific place, but is found in your God. Which can be confusing, again, to a group of people when they're wondering, why God? Where is God? However, this group of people know Psalm 111, which talks again about God being the protector and the provider who will deliver God's people as God had done in the great Exodus. This letter goes through a political emissary to the upper ranks of the Israelite community in exile. Kind of interesting, right? Many scholars believe that the people mentioned in the first verse of Jeremiah are provided actually with the opportunity to create a new life in Babylon. They could have a job, they could create wealth. Still, they are in a foreign land after being taken as captives of war, with the inability to return to the land they call their own. No matter where the Israelite people were, Jeremiah shared that they are to be grounded in the promises of God, yes, even in exile. The truth of Psalm 111 follows the people into exile. They're to build a life and to praise God, for there is hope and deliverance, as was in the past and will be in the future. And in the meantime, live a life that also looks out for the welfare of the place you currently reside in, for their well-being will also mean your well-being. Show the mercy and compassion you know to be true of God, even among foreigners and enemies. Ground yourself, plant yourself, for you will be in exile for quite some time and create this new life in a different place, ultimately grounded in the promises of God. As you did in Israel, may it be so now. Further along in the section of Jeremiah, there's a well-known verse. I'll read from Jeremiah 29, verses 10 through 11. It says, "For thus says the Lord, Only when Babylon's 70 years are completed will I visit you, and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope. Captivity in Babylon is the context for this verse of welfare and not harm. Many of the Israelite people at this time believed their exceptionalism would protect them from harm. This is why the other false prophets were saying it'll be over in a few years and then Israel would be prosperous again. We know this is not the case in this moment. There are times when hardship allows us to grow in strength and resiliency, and other times when hardship allows us to reflect on our lives and ways we can change or improve. And other times, it reveals the state of the world around us in ways we hadn't seen before. Hardships are a part of life, some inevitable, but our response matters as much as the circumstances. And the response to the hardships that don't impact us also matters. We don't read Jeremiah and think the Israelite people deserved to be part of this war. Today, we know that Israel wasn't punished by God, but used this language and framework to make sense of their circumstances. We know that the Israelite people persevere, and their history before this exile shows that to be true. However, we also know the ending of this story. It is one of hope, one of the end of the exile, and the ability for the community to come together and rebuild a new life. However, we also know that war is an unfortunate part of life, and it was even more true for those living in the ancient Near East. And we know that as humans, power grabbing is the ultimate facade of safety, protection, and comfort. This exile did allow for reflection on their part and how they viewed God and one another. The situation of the exiled Israelite people is not a parallel for us to emulate this type of hardship or to note that this hardship is necessary in life, but a reminder that their circumstances taught them how to worship God anywhere. Synagogues became a vital part of the community after the exile, and caring for the community and community building were also important. Rebuilding the foundation. Though we only read Psalm 111 today, Psalm 111 and 112 go together. Psalm 111, as Eileen read, speaks about a God, about who God is and what God has done. While Psalm 12 shares about how the people of God should conduct themselves in response. I think it also speaks a little to what we see in the passage within Jeremiah. I'll read from the Psalm verses 4-6. It says, they rise in the darkness as a light for the upright. They are gracious, merciful, and righteous. It is well with those who deal generously and lend, who conduct their affairs with justice, for the righteous will never be moved. They will be remembered forever. It goes on to say that they are not fearful, the people who praise God, of evil, for their hearts are secure in the Lord. They are grounded in God, and as a result, they can deal with their enemies and still provide for the poor and needy by distributing what they have. Even in exile, Jeremiah exhorts the people to remember Psalm 112 while residing in a foreign and enemy land. Their foundation in God and being God's people is what will bring life out of this terrible situation. So how do we respond to hardship while staying grounded in the promises of God? It involves creating a life where there is none, in creating a community and a new foundation. It may look like going to therapy and saying, I need help, but it definitely involves knowing that God does want the best for us. And sometimes what may not be in our control is a world filled with those vying for power at the expense of people and creation. And so how do we respond to that? It may look like taking a stance against policies that continue to criminalize our neighbors without housing and our immigrant neighbors looking for a better life in a foreign land. It involves understanding and knowing who God is in Psalm 111 and what we have been called to do, as it says in Psalm 112. When some try to claim a Christianity that ignores these Psalms, we speak up and push back and remind them of what these Psalms say. The bedrock is that God cares, God loves, and that God has made it known to all creation in the past, in the present, and will continue to do so in the future. And that is our foundation. We stand our ground there in all that we do, in our love of God and love for one another and for the neighbor and the stranger and even sometimes our enemy. Alleluia.
Alleluia.
It is at this time that we invite anybody who would like to join with this community by making a transfer of membership or making that first good confession of faith in Jesus Christ as Lord. It is at this time that we are all called, that we are all reminded. It is at this time that we are all called.
Invited to.
Thank you. I was like, if it's not called, we are all invited to rededicate our hearts and our lives to the ministry of Jesus Christ. Will you please stand as you are able and sing a hymn of response on Eagle's Leaves, number 77.
And
As you come to the offering invitation today, let's read together the mission statement of VLM. It's up on the screen. To share the joy of God's love, to nurture one another to wholeness, to motivate each other to Worcestershire witness, to effect healing in a hurting world. Sharing, nurturing, motivating, and affecting healing all call us to action. It takes all of us contributing to follow Jesus. Please give as you are able to support our beloved community. Will the deacons please come forward to receive the offering?
Church, for sharing of yourself with those around you, for helping build and maintain this church. Thank you, Father, for teaching us how to be Christian in this hurting world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please be seated. What a gift it is to come to a table, this table, those tables, whatever table. Sometimes the table isn't even a table. Sometimes it's your lap. Sometimes it's whatever you call that thing in between the two front seats of your car, right? That's a table for me sometimes, right? What a gift it is to know that wherever we are, God spreads a table. Welcome, of hospitality, of healing, and love, forgiveness. What a gift it is to know that God's table is wherever God's people need to be fed. We come this day, here in this place, to this table, to proclaim that on the night he was to be betrayed, Jesus gathered with his disciples. And he took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them saying, this bread is my body broken for you. Eat of it, all of you, and remember me. And in a similar way, he took up the cup and having given thanks, poured it out for them saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of it, all of you, and remember me. And so we come, for here is where we are. We come to the table God has prepared to remember Christ our Lord. Will you join me in the communion prayer prepared for us by Communion Elder Larry Knight? Loving God, you are here for us in all times of our lives. You are there in the joyous times and the sad times, the easy times and the hurting times. When we come to times when we are tested, help us to remember Jesus Christ, who bore a greater burden than we ever could, yet remained faithful. At this communion table, we eat the bread and drink the cup that help us recall Christ's saving work. May your spirit of encouragement work in our hearts as we partake, so we might be faithful to you as you are faithful to us. Now hear us as we pray together the prayer Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Let us prepare our hearts to come to the table by singing our communion hymn number 386. We come as guests invited.
Thank you.
point this morning is number 477, pass it on. I invite you to stand as you are comfortable and join me in singing. Of the Holy Spirit. Go in peace. Amen. Amen.